Welcome back to another episode of What's Up, Prof. Hello, Walter.
Hi, Martin.
I am doing well. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
That's good. So what have we in store today?
I thought we'd cross the Jordan.
That sounds good.
Yes, because, you know, crossing the Jordan is the type of going home. Mm-hmm. And I think many are feeling that it really is getting time to go home now.
Yes, it's time to get to Canaan. But you can't cross the Jordan without the Ark of the Covenant.
No, it has to go before you.
So let's open with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you very much for bringing us together again. Lord, we ask that you bless our minds and this discussion and help us to discern the right from wrong. In Jesus' name, amen.
Typology in the Bible. If it weren't for that, it would be a book for a time. But now it is a timeless book. And I think it's time that we looked at some of the typologies again, just to feel secure that we really are going home.
Yeah, yeah. And people have to realize how to implement the typology from what happened then to what's happening now.
Correct. You know, Martin, when it comes to typology, the Bible tells us that we should apply it. Mm-hmm. And one of the texts that are very important for the time, or that is very important for the time we are living in, is 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Paul says, "Moreover, brethren, I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ." But whenever there's such a positive statement, there's always a but, right?
Unfortunately.
But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they lusted. Neither be ye idolaters, as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and rose up to play. Now, would you normally consider that idolatry, Martin?
No.
But this is idolatry, right?
Exactly.
All right, so he's taking it to our time and he's saying they were idolaters. And what were they doing? They were eating, they were drinking, and they rose up to play. So eating and drinking can be an idol. Mm-hmm. There's a right form of eating and drinking, and there's a wrong form of eating and drinking. And they rose up to play. Now, this is an allusion to the Egyptian sport. In the Gilgamesh epic, as we discussed in previous lectures, sport played a very, very important role, and sport was an idol. Mm-hmm. And as we said before, if that round object goes into a net or into a hole, that's the victory of the sun god over his enemies. So there was a religious connotation in sport, and it was an act of worship. Mm-hmm. Now today, we also have an act of worship. We even have the raised arms and everything that goes along with it. It is an act of worship.
Face painting.
Everything. Everything. Everything is exactly the same. So food was an idol and sport was an idol. Neither let us commit fornication. Now, this could be literal fornication or it could be spiritual fornication, right? As some of them committed and fell in one day 23,000. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of the serpents. There's a lot of information in this verse. this tempting of Christ and the serpents involved, this has to do with righteousness by faith. Mm. Because when that serpent was lifted up and you looked upon it, you were healed. So he became sin for us,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then there's the question of murmuring. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. Now all these things happened unto them for ensamples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. We are repeating the history of Israel,
definitely.
Except that we've had a lot of practice and we're improving upon whatever they did, right?
Yeah.
So this is a very important thing to ponder. And we should ask ourselves, what happened to them? Why did it happen to them?
Mm-hmm.
And why was God not well pleased with them? And why were they overthrown in the wilderness? Lest it happens to us, right?
Correct. It is for our ensamble, so we have to learn from it.
Correct. Now, they were all baptized into Moses, it says, right? So the Hebrews were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Having been delivered from slavery to Egypt, they continued in the wilderness, and Christ gave them spiritual food and drink.
Mm-hmm.
Also in a physical form.
Yes.
And that also served as a type of his body, right?
Yes.
So the water is a symbol of deliverance and cleansing, but it's also a symbol of destruction to the enemies of God. There's always this double connotation, right? So if you look at water in the Bible and you see Noah's Ark, the world was destroyed by water,
yeah.
But the Ark was also borne up by water.
Mm-hmm.
And those that were in it, eight of them were saved. Now the number eight is the number of Christ. So those that are in Christ will be saved. But you have to go through this baptism.
Yes.
Now these in the type were baptized into Moses.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? Well, he serves as a type of Christ. And they followed Moses.
Yeah.
In other words, what Moses taught, what Moses believed, what Moses wrote, that was their guide. Of course, it came from God.
Yes.
So he serves only as a type, and he refers to the prophet that would come afterwards. Him you must hear.
Mm.
So they followed the faith of Moses. And we must have the faith of Jesus.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah.
Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the typology is very, very important. So Noah's Ark is a symbol of water, Moses' basket.
Mm-hmm.
It sustained him and he floated,
yes.
But that same water turned to blood.
Correct.
And was a plague. And then you had the parting of the Red Sea. That was a baptism by water. They passed through the water. They came out alive on the other side, and the enemies passed through the water and ended up dead.
Yeah.
And then there's the crossing of the Jordan River. They are examples of God's deliverance through water. Now, the Jordan is particularly interesting because it also stood on a heap.
Yeah.
And they had progressed to a point where the Ark of the Covenant preceded them, right?
Yes.
And the priest carried it. And the water were in flood at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to look at all of these things because they are written as examples for the time in which we are living. So the Hebrews were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, having been delivered from the slavery to Egypt. We have been delivered from the slavery of sin.
Mm.
And instead of Egypt, we come out of Babylon.
Correct.
All right, so now there's a very strong religious connotation. And they continued in the wilderness, and Christ gave them spiritual food and drink. That's what we read. And we are baptized into the death and resurrection of Christ. So the parallels are very important, and the lessons of their walk apply to us.
Correct.
So when we are delivered and we die in baptism,
yes,
then we must be dead to sin but alive to God, right?
Yes.
Romans chapter 6 verses 1 to 4. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many as of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him in baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. Now, Martin, how do you know whether you have performed a ritual or whether you've really undergone a total transformation?
By their fruits you shall know them.
By the fruits. Now, many of the Israelites surely believed what Moses was saying, right?
Yes.
And they followed Moses.
They went,
And they were basically baptized into his belief system, which is the Torah. And many of them fell in the wilderness.
Mm.
So not all of them had a genuine conversion.
Correct.
Yeah, could it be the same in our time?
Definitely.
Okay.
We are bound to repeat what our predecessors did.
Correct. So Israel refused to believe that God would be with them. And this event was the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back. Numbers 14:22 says that this was the 10th time that Israel had tested God. After 10 occasions, it was pretty clear that this generation of the Israelites did not have hearts which trusted God, and so God swore that they would not enter. So if you read Numbers 14:22, it says, because all those men which have seen my glory and my miracles, which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and have tempted me now these 10 times, and have not hearkened unto my voice. So was God patient with them?
Definitely.
All right.
Very patient. And he's shown, even before this, that he's been patient all along with other people as well.
Has he been patient with us?
Oh. Even longer than with them.
Even longer. Even longer. So they passed through the Red Sea. The waters stood on a heap. They were baptized, as it were, into Moses. In other words, they followed him. He put his staff there. They followed. They were basically baptized into his faith. Passed out through the other side. The enemy was destroyed. And they were overjoyed by their deliverance. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
And then they went into the desert, where God had said, I will prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. Martin, how could God have said that if the law had not yet been given?
He wouldn't have been able to.
But he said it, right?
He said it.
Okay. So Exodus chapter 16:35 says, and the children of Israel did eat manna 40 years. Until they came to a land inhabited, they did eat manna. Until they came unto the borders of the land of Canaan. 40 years. Paul called it spiritual food. Mm. It was also physical food.
Yeah.
But they should have learned a lesson with
Correct.
It. Because there were many lessons associated. How long it would last. A miracle every Friday that it lasted 2 days. Yeah. It would not see corruption. Christ's body didn't see corruption. The parallels are very, very beautiful. And then in Numbers 11:18-20 it says, and say thou unto the people, sanctify thyselves against tomorrow, and you shall eat flesh. So here was a type that we need to watch out for. The people craved the flesh pots of Egypt. But not only the flesh pots. They also craved the leeks and the onions and all of... Is there anything wrong with leeks and onions?
No.
I have a whole lot of them growing in my garden. Nothing wrong with leeks and onions, right? It's the palate that we're talking about, the association. But particularly the flesh was a problem. And the Lord said, for you have wept in the ears of the Lord, saying, who shall give us flesh to eat? For it was well with us in Egypt. Therefore the Lord will give you flesh, and you shall eat. You shall not eat 1 day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days, but even a whole month, until it come out of your nostrils, and it be loathsome unto you, because that you have despised the Lord which is among you, and have wept before him, saying, why came we forth out of Egypt? Now, Martin, was this the first time that they got meat or the second time?
Second time.
Did this happen, anything bad happen the first time?
No.
God showed them that he was displeased because they murmured against Moses, mm-hmm. but he didn't do anything.
No.
He didn't reprimand them with a plague.
No.
But on this occasion, and while the flesh was yet between their teeth, ere it was chewed, the wrath of the Lord was kindled against the people, and the Lord smote the people with a very great plague. Martin, if we take the health message, how long have we had it?
170 years.
It's a long time, right?
Hmm.
And has God been very tolerant when it comes to the craving for flesh food and perverted palates?
Yes. Definitely.
He has, right? Mm-hmm. Now, we live in a country where flesh food is the ultimate diet, right?
Mm-hmm.
And anything else is considered garnish.
Yes.
And within the church, we have the same problem.
Mm-hmm.
And God has been very tolerant. And we have statements in the spirit of prophecy which say, meat eating is not a test of fellowship. In other words, I can't say I don't want to associate you with you because you eat meat. But we also have statements which say that your spiritual discernment will be clouded if you partake in flesh foods. And we have very strong statements which say that you cannot trust what comes from a pulpit if it is associated with the consumption of flesh foods. So it's a very important issue. And God, in his mercy, has tried to train our people to move in the right direction.
The same that he did with Israel.
The same. Training. He was very tolerant, right? And so he tolerated it. And it's not a test of fellowship. Not at all. But this second time, it's associated with a plague. Now, Martin, if the type existed, then what's the probability that there'll be an antitype?
100%.
So if the tolerance has lasted until now, is it possible that sometime in the future, or even now already, that tolerance, that protection, shall I put it that way, is removed not because God is vindictive, but because we are so stubborn?
Definitely.
You think so?
Yeah. We've even showed some of the quotes previously.
Correct. And we'll show some more.
And we'll show some more because this is a very important subject, very important point.
Yes. And people don't want to grasp that what you eat and what you drink is also associated with your moral choices.
It's amazing to me, again, it's putting the Bible and science to weigh unto each other. And they have to decide who they're going to trust.
Okay. Now, when you look at the statistics that they're handing out in the world as to people who are succumbing to the diseases which are so prevalent in the world today, it's mainly elderly people who have degenerative diseases already. So already they're not in good shape, right? They have cardiovascular diseases. They have arthritis. They have many, many problems. And they are immunocompromised. Then the other category that is mentioned is the obese people. They have a problem. So it seems to me that if you do not adhere to the principles of health, you fall into a higher risk category when it comes to the modern day plagues.
Yes.
So is there perhaps a parallel that we can draw out here?
Definitely.
So what is your suggestion for the people of God considering the history of Israel?
Well, my suggestion is, as in also one of the previous WhatsApp profs that we showed, weigh your science that you trust on against the Bible. If the science correlates and agrees, then you're on the right track. Then follow that. But if it's in conflict with the Bible, like we've shown here, disregard it, even though the world will tell you that is the correct one.
Correct. So the world is heavily into animal protein as the best source. And that comes from a totally erroneous concept where they considered that animal protein was of a higher quality than plant protein and was to be the primary source of protein because of the amino acid composition, which is a complete protein, whereas plants generally are incomplete proteins. But of course, you're not supposed to be a monoculture individual. You don't only eat one kind of food. So we discussed in one of the last ones the niacin shortage. When you don't have bread and wheat, for example. So if you only have corn, you can have a niacin deficiency. But if you have wheat along with it, you don't have a deficiency. And you don't have these diseases. So God provided a vast variety. And he wants us to enjoy that variety. But modern society brushes that variety aside and concentrates on animal protein. And what are we having tonight, Martin? Is it going to be beef or is it going to be chicken?
No, it will be beef because chicken is a vegetable.
You're quite right. That was my argument in the old days. But just think about it. That is what people say. I've never heard when somebody says, "What are we having for supper tonight?" that the person will say, "We are having potatoes," or "We are having broccoli," or "We are having carrots." Never. It's always beef or chicken or lamb, or pork, or whatever it is, right? That's the supper. What's the rest then?
No. Add on.
It's garnish, yeah, right?
Garnish.
So this is a typology which we are well on the way to fulfilling. And I believe that this second portion, where the wrong type of diet and the wrong type of craving was associated with the people of God, it was associated with a plague. Here it's quite clear that God sent the plague. But it could just also be interpreted God permitted a plague in the end times, right?
Exactly, exactly.
Okay, so that just as a warning to God's people that lifestyle plays a very important part in the end time, besides the spiritual aspects.
Correct.
Now, I think we've read this one before, but because it is so seldom quoted in the world, I thought it would be a good thing just to read it again.
Yeah.
Because repetition is a very important thing.
Yeah, we've learned this from our news media that's continually repeating certain things and people are getting accustomed to it.
So are you following a good example here, Martin?
I don't know if it's a good example.
The sanctification set forth in the scripture embraces the entire being, spirit, soul, and body. Paul prayed for the Thessalonians that their whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Again he writes to the believers, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. Quoting Romans 12, verse 1. The Jews were commanded to offer in sacrifice to God only such animals as were free from disease or blemish. So Christians are required to preserve all their powers in the best possible condition for the Lord's service. Says Peter, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. The word of God will make but a feeble impression upon those whose faculties are benumbed by any sinful gratification. The heart cannot preserve consecration to God while the animal appetites and passions are indulged at the expense of health and life. Paul writes to the Corinthians, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And with the fruits of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, he classes temperance. Now, Martin, people will say, well, we only eat clean meat, clean food, clean animals. And I gave a number of lectures a few years ago already about the condition of the meat industry, what animals are fed, how they are raised. And that if you look at the principles in the Bible and you see what are the criteria that are attached to an unclean animal, you will find, number one, that all carnivores are unclean. Mm-hmm. Every single one. There is not one clean carnivore.
Correct.
Only herbivores are classed as clean. And then only such herbivores that do not recycle their food from the rectum. Mm-hmm. In other words, that are not coprophages. Mm-hmm. So a rabbit and a horse that have cecal fermentation, which is at the end of the intestine, and pass it through a second time, are unclean by virtue of the toxins which accumulate in them. And there were experiments that were done where they took the extracts from the flesh of unclean animals versus clean animals and looked at the effect on the growth of, let's say, a bean variety. And if it was a clean animal, it was not stunted. But if it was an unclean animal, it stunted the growth.
Okay.
So the same will happen to you, right? So God tried to lead his people back to a vegetarian lifestyle. We've had this message for well over a century. Mm-hmm. And many of our people ignore it. And sooner or later, the more they lust it, the more immunocompromised they will be, and the more likely is that they could succumb to a plague. This is pretty direct language, but this is the way it goes. Now, today, I don't believe there is anything like a clean animal left on the planet. Because even if their diet is free range, they are still subject to zoonotic diseases. In other words, diseases that affect the animal, which are now trans-specific. So in the old days, you had bird flu, and it affected birds. Mm. Now bird flu affects humanity. In the old days, you had swine flu, and it affected swine. Now it affects humanity.
Yeah.
In the old days, you had foot and mouth disease. They call these viral diseases. Now it affects humanity. There is no such thing today anymore, in my opinion, as a clean animal, even in the best of circumstances. Because you can have a free-range chicken, but it can still get a viral disease, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is transmissible to humanity.
Yeah.
And we've had this message which says that disease is increasing in proportion to the wickedness of men. The time will come when there will be no safety in partaking of any animal product, whether it be dairy or meat or any one of those. We've had this message. Has God given us alternatives?
Yes.
So those that want substitutes which taste like the real thing, are there enough of them on the shelves?
Yes, or you can prepare your own way. You can prepare it for yourself.
So you will come short in nothing.
No.
There are statements which says God will give culinary skill to his people in different parts of the world. So Martin, if you really are a food junkie, you can look at the foods in the various parts of the world, and we have access to recipes galore.
Correct.
You can punch in Indian food and get Indian varieties. You can get Eastern foods. You can get anything under the sun. And you can have a culinary experience without once putting a morsel of flesh or animal-derived food into your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
We have no excuse, right?
No, that's true.
Do our people still make excuses?
Yes.
Is God well pleased with those that still make excuses?
No. Because as we've shown, God's number one reason is to get your mind clear.
Yes.
And secondary, he wants you to be healthy as well.
Correct. So he cares for both of them. So we read in the spirit of prophecy that this branch of the Lord's work, the health message, in other words, has not received due attention. And through this neglect, much has been lost. If the church would manifest a greater interest in the reforms through which God himself is seeking to fit them for his coming, their influence would be far greater than it is now. You know, Martin, that's an incredible statement. Do you mean there are so many that are neglecting the health message that their influence has become stunted?
Correct. It's sad.
God has spoken to his people and he designs that they shall hear and obey his voice. Although the health reform is not the third angel's message, it is closely connected with it. And those who proclaim the message should teach health reform also. It is a subject that we must understand in order to be prepared for the events that are close upon us. So Martin, how important do you think it is?
Very important.
It's very important. It's the right arm of the third angel's message.
So that means it's going to have to influence choice.
And it's going to influence your choice.
Yeah.
And if you just run along and don't change anything, you will be swept away because according to the spirit of prophecy, you won't have discernment.
Mm-hmm. It's strong words, but if God said it, we must trust that it's going to be like this.
He says in Psalms, they lusted and he sent leanness into their soul. Yeah. Now, this is not God punishing you.
No.
This is you punishing yourself.
Through a choice. Correct.
All right. Now we could go into the physiology of what the animal products do. Animal fats clog the system. Animal fats clog the way in which your brain functions. If you have the wrong type of food without the complex carbohydrates, then you don't have the correct brain food. Your brain functions on pure carbohydrate and it needs the right combinations. All of these factors affect your thinking.
And it's actually very elementary, very easy. You read, God says, don't eat the fat.
Correct. Of the animals.
Correct. He doesn't give a reason. He says, don't eat it. But now you've got science that's trying to prove that fat is good for you.
Yes.
Animal fat.
But what kind of fat? You see, fat, animal fat, consists of stearic acid. And that's a saturated fat. Now, some plant fats are also saturated fats, like coconut oil. Mm-hmm. But that's not stearic acid.
Correct.
It's palmitic acid. And the interesting thing is palmitic acid has a totally different metabolism to stearic acid. It is a fat that is easily utilized and convert it in the human body, where stearic acid is stored and stored in the blood vessels. It affects your oxygen transport. It affects your cardiovascular system. The differences are absolutely amazing. So the plant fats, the ones that we should consume, should be the plant fats that are saturated, would be like coconut oil, etc. Monounsaturated fats, we will find them in nuts and seeds and in olives. The oil as it is in the olive is most wholesome.
Correct. And that just brings me back to the point that I made earlier. The Bible says stay away from fat.
Yes.
These animal fat. Because where he said don't eat the fat, he was talking about animal fat.
Correct.
So if your science is not correlating with that, it's false science.
Correct.
That's as easy as that.
When the widow's jar was filled with oil, was it animal oil or was it olive oil?
Olive oil.
It was olive oil. So there are many, many places in the Bible where there are just statements and science has corroborated them. There's not a scientist in the world that knows his oats that will recommend animal fat. So Martin, one of the lessons that the Israelites had to learn that were written for our example is the one on diet, right? Mm-hmm. They really struggled with that one. And thereafter, once they came into Canaan, God permitted them to go in their way, but he said, I don't want you to transgress my health laws.
Yes.
And he gave Moses a very specific set of health laws. And had they adhered to it, they would have been spiritually discerning.
Correct.
Now, God says that he was not well pleased with that generation, and we'll look at some of these issues. And finally, when they came to the borders of Canaan, and they were going to cross into Canaan, they sent out 12 spies. Now, Martin, how many of those spies came back with a good report?
Only two.
Only two. Joshua and Caleb. Mm. And 10 of them had a bad report, right? Now, let's unpack that a little bit. Mm. So, Joshua and Caleb were baptized into Moses.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
So, whatever Moses wrote, whatever Moses believed, they had assimilated it. And the food that they ate was not just food to them, it was also spiritual food. So they grew in faith. Mm. They saw what happened at the Red Sea. They saw what happened in the wilderness. And they accepted the lessons. And they were two of the spies that were sent out, Joshua and Caleb. Did they believe what Moses believed?
Yes.
Did they therefore believe that what God had promised he could also perform?
Yes.
Did they base their knowledge of what they believed also on past experience?
Correct, yeah.
They saw what he had done to the Egyptians. They believed he would do it to the Canaanites. So when they saw the giants, did their knees buckle?
No.
No.
No, they stood strong.
Because what happened to the Egyptians? They never even lifted a sword, right?
Exactly.
And they said when they came back, we are well able to take it. And it is a land flowing with milk and honey. You know what's interesting to me? I don't think it was Joshua and Caleb that carried that bunch of grapes between them. I think it was one of the other 10. And in spite of it, they were opposed. Now, did Joshua and Caleb bring a good testimony?
Yes, they had a positive testimony, so it was a good testimony.
They brought a good testimony. Was the testimony that they brought in harmony with what Moses had written?
Yes.
So what Moses was written was known as the law, the Torah, right?
Yes.
So what they believed was the law, And they had a testimony which was in harmony with the law.
Correct.
So do you think they believed in the law and the testimony proved it?
Yes.
So could we in a sense say, Martin, that the two spies stand for the law and the testimony?
Yes. Definitely.
And the ten, did they believe the Torah that God was going to do this for them?
There were certain portions that they believed, but they didn't believe that God will deliver them.
The giants are too big.
Yeah.
We can't go and fight against those. Forget it. It's a lost cause. Yes, the land is like a land flowing with milk and honey, but you guys have deceived us. We want to go back to Egypt.
Yeah.
Didn't they say that? Mm-hmm. It's going to be too tough. Martin, is there a lesson in that?
Oh, definitely.
All right. Now, what was the ratio? So the ratio is pretty scary, right? Yeah.
10 to 2.
10 to 2. And when they brought a good report, those two, didn't the people pick up stones?
Yes. They wanted to stone them to death.
And they sided with whom?
With
the ten.
Yes.
It's interesting. I think I have the quote in here somewhere where the spirit of prophecy says, even if only if 10 had brought a good report, the people would still have sided with the with those that brought the bad report, even if there were only two.
That's true.
Okay. So what does that tell us about the spiritual preparedness of the majority of the people?
They're not ready.
They're not ready to take it,
They're not ready to go into Canaan.
They're not ready. Mm-hmm. And they were sent back.
Yes.
They'd already wandered for 2 years. Now they were sent back to make a total of 40 years. Mm. So they had to wander another 38 years without reaching Canaan. All right. Now, those two spies, if they represent the law and the testimony, and then they had to go back because nobody listened. Do we have anything similar that happened within the Advent movement?
Yes.
Could they have gone in at a particular stage?
Mm-hmm. Hmm? 1888.
Yes. Now tell me, Martin, just for interest's sake, how many in 1888 had a good report?
Probably two.
Two. Wasn't it Jones and Wagner?
Yes.
How many is that?
Two.
Jones and Wagner. One. That's two, right? Two had a good report. How many picked up stones?
The rest.
The rest.
Yeah.
So have we repeated that history?
Yes. We've met the antitype.
We've met the antitype. And we've gone back a one ring.
Uh-huh.
Fortunately for you and me. Because we're the next generation, right? That could come in. You're even a generation after me, right?
Yeah.
So, interesting, right?
Very interesting.
Two brought a good report.
Mm-hmm. Gives you quite an eye-opener of where we are in the stream of time.
It's fascinating. And that was in 1888, Martin. Mm-hmm. That's a long time ago, right? So God was not pleased.
Yeah.
And many of those had to fall in the wilderness. And then there was a second attempt to go in. But let's just read here. Patriarchs and prophets. The Canaanites had filled up the measure of their iniquity, and the Lord would no longer bear with them. His protection being removed, they would be an easy prey. By the covenant of God, the land was ensured to Israel. But the false report of the unfaithful spies was accepted, and through it the whole congregation were deluded. The traitors had done their work. If only the two men had brought the evil report, and all the ten had encouraged them to possess the land in the name of the Lord, they would still have taken the advice of the two in preference to the ten, because of their wicked unbelief. But there were only two advocating the right, while ten were on the side of rebellion. We've repeated that history verbatim.
Yeah.
Except they weren't called Caleb and Joshua. They were called Jones and Wagner. The unfaithful spies were loud in denunciation of Caleb and Joshua, and the cry was raised to stone them. The insane mob seized missiles with which to slay those faithful men. They rushed forward with yells of madness. When suddenly the stones dropped from their hands, a hush fell upon them and they shook with fear. God had interposed to check their murderous design. The glory of his presence, like a flaming light, illuminated the tabernacle. All the people beheld the signal of the Lord, a mightier one than they had revealed himself, and none dared continue their resistance. The spies who brought the evil report crouched terror-stricken and with bated breath sought their tents. Martin, we are living in an antitypical world right now.
Mm-hmm.
And when we look at the world and the information that is coming from our ranks, is there a great majority that is shouting that we are living in the end times, that we are going home, and if we stand true to principles, we are well able to enter into the land, or is it a minority?
Minority. Unfortunately.
2 out of 12?
Yep.
You think it's possible?
Yep. The ratio still stands.
Do you think the others are shouting vehemently against them, calling them all kinds of derogatory names?
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible?
Yeah, definitely.
Writing articles in their little spiritual magazines against those that are trying to raise the alarm that the time has come?
Yep. It's happening.
Do you think camps are forming where they're saying that these will be a danger to society and to the church, and we should pick up stones and get rid of them?
Yes.
Do you think it's possible?
Definitely.
Martin, are you trying to make me nervous?
No.
But I still say we are well able.
If we take the type, then we have nothing to fear in the antitype if you're on the side of God.
So if you're on the side of God, when Christ comes, and there is this heavenly illumination, there may be some of them will want to run to their tents.
Correct.
So how convinced are you, Martin, that we have reached the culmination point of the antitype?
I'm 100% convinced.
You are?
Mm-hmm.
So two entered, Joshua and Caleb. Only two. Of that vast crowd.
This is now the second time at
the
Jordan.
Second time.
Correct. So now after the 38 years, not one of those 10 spies
entered in. Not one. That's a very serious issue, right? Okay. Now, when they got to the border the second time, how many spies did they send in?
Just two.
Just two, not 12?
No.
That didn't work so well last time, right?
No.
Now, there's an antitype there, which is fascinating. In other words, these people were now ready to enter in.
Yeah.
Okay? They believed the law. They believed the testimony. And two spies went in. Wasn't necessary to send 12. And two represents the law and the testimony.
Correct.
They believed it. So if we look at the outcome of what happened to those two that believed in the law and a good testimony. When they came back, did they bring a good testimony?
Yes.
Yes.
Very good.
They spoke about the conversations they heard and that they were surely going to be able to do this. And they met this lady, Rahab, right? Now, Rahab was a prostitute. And she lived on the wall. Now, in the Bible, a wall around the city is the protection.
Mm-hmm.
And the symbol that God uses for his church, the wall around it, represents the law.
Yes.
Now, Rahab lived on the wall, or in the wall, because the walls were very thick and they had apartments in them, and she was associated with the wall. So, typologically, could we say that Rahab and is a woman, and a woman represents a church, and it is a church that was apostate, because that's represented as a prostitute, right?
Yes.
If we had to make an antitype out of it. So even in a place like Jericho, which was an idolatrous city, there was a woman who still had some connection with the wall. And the promise was made to her that her whole family and anyone who came to her house would be saved.
Correct.
So in the end of time, will those churches that weren't aware of the law and the testimony, will eventually some of them will come to the conclusion that they must side with the people of God?
Yes.
And they put a crimson lint out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which represents the sacrifice of Christ.
Yeah.
Which means that they accepted the atonement of Jesus Christ and the two witnesses, the law and the testimony that came to them,
yes,
and joined God's people, right?
Mm.
How firmly did they join God's people? Well, if you go to Ruth chapter 4, it says, and Salmon begat Boaz. It doesn't say in this verse who the mother of Boaz was, but who was she?
Rahab.
Rahab, the prostitute. And then who was Salmon? He could have been one of the spies, right?
Yes.
So one of the spies married Rahab. And they begat Boaz, and Boaz begat Obed, and Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Boaz married who?
Ruth.
All right, and Ruth was a Moabitess, right?
Mm-hmm.
So here are sister churches, let's put it that way, because the Moabites came from Lot.
Yeah.
The daughters of Lot.
Mm-hmm.
So they were also apostate and prostitutes, etc. But some of them said, like Ruth, your God will be my God and your people will be my people.
Yes.
That's coming out of her, my people, and joining yourself to those who believe the law and the testimony.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that Christ incorporates all of these into his own genealogy.
Mm. So right? It means that from every corner.
Amazing. The typology is so stunning to me.
And the only thing that they have to do to be incorporated there is to believe the law and the testimony.
Correct. Did Rahab believe the spies?
Yes.
So she believed the testimony.
Correct.
And she believed the law because she'd seen what the people had been through. They knew everything that happened to the Egyptians, etc. And there was no heart in them.
Yeah.
So an amazing, amazing typology in this story. But then again, let's read what it says in the spirit of prophecy. A few miles beyond the river, just opposite the place where the Israelites were encamped, was the large and strongly fortified city of Jericho. This city was virtually the key to the whole country, and it would present a formidable obstacle to the success of Israel. Joshua therefore sent two young men as spies to visit this city and ascertain something as to its population, its resources, and strength of its fortifications. The inhabitants of the city, terrified and suspicious, were constantly on the alert, and the messengers were in great danger. Martin, do you think as we enter the second time now into Canaan, because surely we're going there the second time, right?
Definitely.
Do you think there will be great danger?
Yes.
Will the city look extremely fortified?
Yes.
And this city has to be taken down, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible talks much about a city that is an enemy city in the book of Revelation.
Correct.
Right? Good. So these people were actually terrified and suspicious, were constantly on the alert, and the messengers were in great danger. They were, however, preserved by Rahab, a woman of Jericho, at the peril of her own life. In return for her kindness, they gave her a promise of protection when the city should be taken. The spies returned in safety with the tidings, quote, "Truly the Lord has delivered into our hands all the land, and even all the inhabitants of the country do faint because of us." Is there an antitype?
Definitely.
Even though the odds look terribly against us, right?
Yeah. There will be only a small minority, but the people will be terrified.
In the end, because when they see the signs fulfilling, they will know that they have been deceived, right? Mm.
That's maybe a good reason why not to always stand with the majority.
Correct. It had been declared to them in Jericho, "We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what ye did unto the kings of the Amorites that were on the other side of Jordan, Sihon and Og, whom ye utterly destroyed. And as soon as we had heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and in the earth beneath." So they might pick up those stones and pick up those swords to put an end to you, but God will intervene. So Martin, this story about the healing of the at the pool of Bethesda, in John chapter 5, from verse 1 to 9, is very interesting. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. It's very interesting. It's the sheep market, so it's where they sold sacrificial animals. And it had five porches, and five is the number of humanity. You have five senses, etc. And in these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatever disease he had, and a certain man was there which had an infirmity 38 years. Now, Martin, this is a very interesting story with a very interesting spiritual application. Some of the Bible translations say that this portion about the stirring of the water shouldn't be there. And they don't agree that the King James included it, for example. Mm. Which is a tragedy, of course, because it's sad when they remove certain portions.
And the spiritual lesson, after you know what it is,
no,
that emphasizes the tragedy that they want to leave it out.
Exactly. So if this portion tells about this story, it doesn't mean that this is true, that the people were healed when they got out. This is what the people believed.
Yes.
Right? So they had developed a belief system which was based on certain events which had to take place. Mm. You know, we have in the world today a very similar religious system where God is healing certain people apparently when they pass through certain waters or go to certain evangelistic meetings, etc., etc., where people fall down, get up, throw their crutches away, and next week you see them walking with their crutches. And it's a belief system of, well, if you can only do this, if I could only go to Lourdes and get some holy water on me, I might be cured of whatever malady I have.
Yeah.
If I could only make a pilgrimage to the Vatican, if I could only see an apparition, if I could only go to Guadalupe to see whether I could get healed there, etc., etc. Or if I could only go to the healers in the Philippines that will put their hand without surgery into me and remove a tumor, then I would be fine. This is the type of religion that the world has. Mm-hmm. It is a miracle awaiting religion. Mm. And because of the miracles, people were deceived,
correct,
says the Bible. So they had a form of religion.
Mm-hmm.
And here this man was lying there together with a lot of impotent, blind, halt, and withered people. And he was lying there for 38 years. Now that number is not an arbitrary number.
No.
The children of Israel had wandered 2 years. They came to the border. And because of unbelief, they were turned back.
Exactly.
And they had to wander another 38 years.
Mm-hmm.
This was a symbol of the state of Israel that was in exactly the same place as the children of Israel were that had wandered. Mm. And they were impotent. They didn't know where to go. They were blind. They were halt and they were withered. Their religion was withered. It was based on fable,
exactly,
and fantasy. It was spiritual formation at its best. Mm. It was an empty religion of form. And Jesus, ignoring the stupidity of the water, went and asked him, "Do you want to be healed?" When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in this case, he says unto him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The impotent man answered him, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." Did Jesus say to him, "Come, let me help you into the pool"?
No.
No, he distanced himself from the stupidity of that belief, right?
Correct.
Now, do we have the world's churches in the same state? Do you think that they are impotent, blind, halt, and withered? And we're about to enter into Canaan. He was there 38 years.
Yeah.
It was time to go home.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Correct.
Do you think it's time for us to go home?
Yes, definitely.
Have we wandered long enough in this wilderness?
Yes.
Are we going to send out 12 or only 2 spies?
2.
Only the law and the testimony, and that's it, right? And we're going to go across that Jordan. And immediately the man was made whole because his faith wasn't based on liturgy. It was based in a faith in what Jesus had promised and what the Bible had promised. Mm-hmm. And this is the kind of healing that we need. So this halt man, this impotent, withered human being, spiritually, religiously withered. He didn't have the faith of Abraham, right? Martin, I find it interesting that if you go and you look at Abraham and you look at the promises to Abraham, that there are certain parallels which we need to take note of. So I just want to go there because there were 7 promises with blessings that were given to Abraham on a condition.
Yeah, correct.
And we read it in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 to 3. And he is the father of them that believe. Mm-hmm. And he's also the father of spiritual Israel.
Yeah.
Now the Lord had said unto Abraham, "Get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee." Now, Martin, that's quite a tall order. Get out of your country.
Mm-hmm.
The country represents the world.
Yeah.
We have to come out of this world, right?
Yes.
From your kindred, out of your family.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, even out of your religious family, you have to come out of Babylon.
Yes.
And from your father's house, there will be separation even on a filial level.
Mm-hmm.
Unto a land that I will show ye. Now to us, that is the heavenly Canaan.
Correct.
Now Martin, isn't it surprising to you that so many of the churches are jumping onto the climate bandwagon trying to fix this world because this is where their heart is?
No, it boggles my mind.
Have they come out?
No.
Or are they trying to fix what's left?
Trying to fix it.
Isn't that a problem?
Yeah. Most of these religions and people are trying to build a kingdom here with this fallen world.
With this fallen world. Where there's a better country that God will show us, right? And then it says, and I will make thee a great nation. That's one promise. I will bless thee. I will make thy name great. That's the third promise. Thou shalt be a blessing. Fourth promise. And I will bless them that bless thee. Fifth promise. Curse them that curse thee. Sixth promise. And in thee all the families of the earth will be blessed. There were seven promises. Seven promises which were of a personal nature and of a corporate nature. Yeah. So, Martin, the promises are dependent upon the fact that he has to leave everything behind.
Yeah.
Did God say to him, Abraham, go and fix what is in your place, and then I will make you happy?
No.
I'll give you a truly human life.
No.
Which is what Catholicism promises you, right? Yeah. A truly human life.
Or these other Christian denominations that say we have to get rid of all this evil so that we can have this heaven on earth.
No, you have to come out.
Get out of this.
Because I'm going to show you another place. Mm. Now, seven blessings for Abraham. And there are seven blessings in the book of Revelation. Now, the first one is, blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things that are written therein, for the time is at hand. That's the first blessing to God's end time people. Please study the book of Revelation. Study the prophecies of the end time. Incorporate them, and I will bless you.
Yes.
In other words, the antitypical Calebs and Joshuas that believe in the law and the testimony and take this promise to heart and study the signs of the times, what are the other ten doing to them?
Picking up stones.
Isn't that incredible?
Well, it is typology, so it has to happen.
They're picking up stones, yep. Right? So they're calling them all kinds of names.
Mm-hmm.
And saying that they are stirring up the people.
Yeah.
And we have to stone them. We have to get rid of them.
Yeah.
And we'll write little articles in our little magazines and tell everybody to please pick up stones and silence these people.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're going to be a danger to society.
Yes.
At every level.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bible says, blessed is he that reads and studies the book of Revelation and takes it to heart. In other words, they will have to give the trumpet a certain sound. They will have to warn against the mark of the beast. They will have to warn against the beast of Revelation chapter 13 and the prostitute of Revelation 17. And they can tell them that there is a city coming.
Yes.
And that there will be a destruction of this world and a new world will be created.
Correct. They must prepare the people to enter Canaan, the heavenly one.
Correct.
And they will be stoned for it.
And they will be stoned for it. Correct. And then if you go to chapter 14, verse 13, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. So if you have taken this to heart and you are preaching this message, even if you die, you're not dead.
Yeah.
You're still blessed. But you have to be in this mode. You have to give the trumpet a certain sound. Because blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. That means everybody who has internalized the message, accepted it and preached it.
Correct.
It doesn't matter when they die.
Yeah.
So even if a stone hits you, Martin, it doesn't matter, right?
No.
Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watches and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see his shame. Now, we're going to have a look at that in a little closer detail in a moment. But we've spoken about this so many times. What does it mean to come as a thief? Maybe there's another aspect that we've missed, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's look at that in a moment. But you definitely want the right robe of righteousness.
Definitely. Without that, you are covered in your own sin.
Correct. So there's no room for perfectionism here. Only the righteousness of Christ.
That's it.
And then there's this other one, and he says unto me, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he has said unto me, these are the true sayings of God. That marriage supper, those 10 virgins, there's another lesson there, right?
Yeah.
Blessed and holy is he that has part in the first resurrection, on such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Martin, if you want to have this blessing, you must understand the millennium.
Correct.
Now, is the millennium going to take place here on earth like the world believes?
No, it can't. It cannot. No.
Because the Lord will come, send his angels. You will meet him in the sky. Yeah. He'll take you to the sea of glass, and he'll take you to the celestial city.
Exactly.
So,
and the 7 plagues would have destroyed whatever is on here.
Now, would you have understood that if you hadn't read the book of Revelation?
No.
Because that's the only place where it defines it exactly for you. The difference between the first resurrection, the second resurrection, the millennium in between, and what happens during that millennium while the people of God are taken away. You must study the book of Revelation.
Exactly.
No, we mustn't talk about that. We should only talk about love, right?
Mm. If you can't find the love in the book of Revelation, then you won't find it in the rest of the Bible.
You won't find it elsewhere. And anyway, blessed are they that read the book and take it to heart. And then, behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Is there progression here?
Mm-hmm.
There's a progression, right? And some of those that have preached this message will have fallen asleep. Blessed are they. They're just waiting in the dust to be called forth, right? And blessed are they that do his commandments. That's like the ultimate cherry on top, right? That they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. It's no wonder that Satan hates this verse and perverts it in all the modern translations.
It is horrific what has happened. Has happened to this verse.
And isn't it amazing how happy everybody is with the change? So here is a very interesting progression of 7 blessings for the end time people of God. There were 7 blessings at the beginning for Abraham.
Yeah.
Now, there's also a blessing on watching. If we go to Matthew 24 from verse 42 to 46, watch therefore, for you know not what hour the Lord doth come. But know this, that if the goodman of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched, and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his Lord has made ruler over his household, to give them meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. So, Martin, here's a very special blessing on the watchman.
Yeah.
He has to watch. Who does he have to watch?
You must have to watch for his Lord's coming, so he has to warn.
And he has to watch what the thief is doing, so he can prepare to keep the thief out of his house, right? Mm-hmm. Now, what is the thief going to steal from him? His eternal life.
Yeah.
He wants to rob him of eternal life. Mm-hmm. He wants to sell him a bunch of lies. So you have to warn against the thief, and you have to say the Lord's coming is soon. Is that a very popular message?
No.
And do people array themselves against it and say, stop watching what's happening on the other side of the wall. Just preach love.
Yes.
Is that in harmony with this blessing? Okay. Now, just before they entered in the second time, there was another incident.
Yes.
And it happened at Baal Peor. On the eastern side of Jordan, between the river and the high table land which they had been traversing, was also a plain, several miles in width and extending some distance along the river. This sheltered valley had the climate of the tropics. Oh, it's so nice to bathe in the sun, isn't it? Here flourished the Chittim or acacia tree, giving to the plain the name Vale of Chittim. It was here that the Israelites encamped, and in the acacia groves by the riverside they found an agreeable retreat. But amid these attractive surroundings they were to encounter an evil more deadly than mighty hosts of armed men or the wild beasts of the wilderness. That country, so rich in natural advantages, had been defiled by the inhabitants. In the public worship of Baal, the leading deity, the most degrading and iniquitous scenes were constantly enacted. On every side were places noted for idolatry and licentiousness, and the very names being suggestive of the vileness and corruption of the people. Martin, are we living in a world where vileness and corruption are surrounding us every single day?
Definitely. Yes.
These surroundings exerted a polluting influence on the Israelites. Their minds became familiar with the vile thoughts constantly suggested. Their life of ease and inaction produced its demoralizing effects, and almost unconsciously to themselves, they were departing from God and coming into a condition where they would fall an easy prey to temptation. Are we living in an antitype?
Definitely. If you look at what's being fed to you through the media, movies, music.
And there were these beautiful ladies, these Moabite and Midianite ladies, with their short little dresses. And they enticed the Israelites. So that is a symbol of the other churches that had lost their connection with God, enticing God's people. Now, Martin, in 2017, in October, in fact, on the 31st of October 2017, the world celebrated the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. But for the first time in the history of this celebration, there was an ecumenical, massive outreach where all the churches participated, and the papacy and the Reformed churches celebrated the event together. They had already announced that the Reformation was at an end. And that which Martin Luther feared the most actually took place. The Reformation, in a sense, formally died.
Yeah.
And they were dancing with Midianite women and Moabite women. And all the churches participated and sold out the law and the testimony. A very sad, sad event. And we've been through that. So that means that Canaan must be just ahead, right?
Yes. It's important to realize that.
Because people are constantly asking us, where are we in the stream of time? We're on the banks of the Jordan.
Definitely. And sitting in Sichem at
Correct.
This stage.
Now, when that Jordan opened up, when those priests put their foot in the Jordan and that water receded several miles, the Israelites were allowed to cross, but they weren't allowed to come near the ark.
No.
They didn't have holy flesh, you know that? They were still subject.
You had to keep your distance.
You had to keep your distance. You had to have your faith. They crossed across. They took 12 stones out of the river and erected a pillar. And they carried them. One representative carried a big stone. They were strong men. Carried those stones across. And the fear of God came into the other people. And even though they were in distress because they took part in the first Passover, and they also were circumcised. So the other nations could have attacked them, right? but they fully healed. And then they took Jericho. We've discussed that. We're on the verge of these events. Now, here's an interesting statement that I just want to read. All who would have their names retained in the book of life should now, in the few remaining days of their probation, afflict their souls before God by sorrow for sin and true repentance. Martin, this is what we should be doing in the time that we are living in.
100%. You know, it is the same, the three angels' messages.
Yes.
The first and second, every time when you have to go through this experience, you have to go through, get sorrow for sin and get true repentance.
All right, so should we be preaching sustainable development and climate change, or should we be preparing a people for the coming of the Lord?
Preparing people for the coming of the Lord and to enter Canaan.
Okay. There must be deep, faithful searching of heart. The light, frivolous spirit indulged by the majority of professed Christians must be put away. There's earnest warfare before all who would subdue the evil tendencies that strive for the mastery. I think we're at that point, as we said,
mm-hmm.
when plagues will take God's people away if they do not conform and come into harmony with God's will. Solemn are the scenes connected with the closing work of the atonement. Momentous are the interests therein involved. The judgment is now passing in the sanctuary above. 40 years has this work been in progress. Martin, it's now much longer than that, right?
Correct.
Soon, none know how soon, it will pass to the cases of the living. In the awful presence of God, our lives are to come up in review. At this time, above all others, it behooves every soul to heed the Savior's admonition. Watch! And pray, for you know not when the time is. Watch ye therefore, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. Martin, is it possible that we have been thinking that we do not know the time, exactly the hour, and all of these things applies only to the second coming? Doesn't it also apply to the close of our personal probation?
That's correct.
If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Revelation 3 verse 3. Mm. This has nothing to do with the second coming.
No, it's got to do with the close of probation. For
are we right with God? You know, we are told that we will have an experience which is akin to Jacob's trouble. And Jacob's trouble was, are my sins forgiven? Mm. I will not let you go lest you bless me.
Yeah.
We need to have a time of serious soul searching in the time that we are living in. We need to make right with God. We need to ask ourselves, have I fulfilled the conditions? Have mm-hmm. I come out of my country?
Yes. Have I come out of my family?
Have I come out of my family? Have I come out in every aspect? Have I separated myself from this world that is heading towards a destruction similar to that which struck Jericho? Mm. Am I associated with the law and the testimony?
Yeah. That's
Am I right with God? How perilous is the condition of those who, growing weary of their watch, turn to the attractions of the world, while the man of business is absorbed in the pursuit of gain, while the pleasure lover is seeking indulgence, while the daughter of fashion is arraigning her adornments. It may be in that hour that the judge of the earth will pronounce the sentence, thou art weighed in the balances and are found wanting. Serious issue.
Very.
Serious
issue. Life and death. Eternal death.
Every soul that has named the name of Christ has a case pending at the heavenly tribunal. It is a court week with us, and the decision passed upon each case will be final. So in other words, the coming as a thief is the judgment, and not necessarily only the second coming. Possible?
Correct. It's very possible.
With that in mind, Martin, is it time to give the trumpet a certain sound?
Definitely. It's time to stand on the wall.
Is it time to get your life in order?
Yes.
Is it time to wrestle with God mm-hmm. and say, I will not let you go unless you bless me?
Yes.
Is it time to align yourself with the law and the testimony? Is it time to warn humanity of what is coming?
Yes.
Have we progressed through the typology to the point of the second entry? Have we even passed Baal Peor?
I think so.
Have we danced with the Midianite women and sat in their ecumenical councils and pretended to be one of them?
Yes. That part is already actually
It's all
passed.
Done. It's yes. all done. So what's left?
Going through the Jordan.
Will there be a plague like there was in Baal Peor?
Definitely.
There will be a plague. May God help us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we have passed through the streams of time. We are on the banks of the Jordan. We have fulfilled the typology to the letter. We've wandered the antitypical 38 years. We're there a second time. We've completed the Baal Peor debacle. And now the ark will go before us, the law and the testimony. May we follow with awe and reverence. Help us to get our lives in order. And help us to be part of that group that finally enters into the country that you will show us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.